Good afternoon, everybody. Yes, like Raymond said, I want to report on a project that we did in the context of trade with the Movember organization, a project on active surveillance patients that suffered from prostate cancer. This project is funded by the Movember Foundation, which I will explain further. So the Movember Foundation is a global men's health charity. It's committed to men living happier, healthier, and living longer lives. It's funded in its foundations are in 2003. In the meantime, they've gathered a group of 5 million members, and in total they have collected over more than $700 million of funds in those years. They are headquartered in Melbourne, Australia. So they fund all kinds of research projects, breakthrough research projects, innovative research projects, and they also support all kinds of programs. They're funding more than 1,200 of those projects, of which the project I'm going to report upon is one. And those programs focus on basically on prostate cancer, testicular cancer, and poor mental health and also physical inactivity. The project I'm going to report upon is the so-called Global Action Plan, the third. It's on active surveillance of prostate cancer patients, and the aim is to construct a sustainable worldwide database comprising clinical data, marker-related and imaging data. Active surveillance itself is an emerging of its importance has increased and emerged in the recent years as a viable option for men with low risk prostate cancer to decide not to undergo some immediate surgery or radiation therapy. During this active surveillance, men are monitored carefully to look for signs of progression, and if symptoms develop, then treatment might be warranted. The project started in 2014. It runs until early next year. A continuation is foreseen to sustain also the database for other use. It's a project with 14 clinical centers, the so-called core centers, from different regions all over the world. So the aim of the project is to create a global consensus on selection and monitoring of men with low prostate cancer, and managing a worldwide platform of with information and guidelines on active surveillance. And also one of the aims is to reduce the number of men switching from active surveillance towards active therapy within 1 year after start of that active surveillance. Overall milestones are to create that global active surveillance database with all the data and a worldwide tailor-made guidelines on active surveillance. In the project there are also statisticians, so next to the clinical partners there are also a group of statisticians that involved that defined also a number of research questions they would like to answer based on the data that is gathered in this project. One is to define what is low risk favorable disease. This is a very difficult task. The main task will be to achieve consensus all over the world to get this definition okay. And also to identify appropriate candidates for active surveillance, and also appropriate markers for that triggers intervention. And what is also taken into account is definitions and selection might also be dependent on patient risk tolerance, also life expectancy, the preferences also of the patients, also contrasting the side effects of the treatment. We did the research data management within this project, so we are basically the IT partner in this project. And we designed and constructed the database, we designed and constructed the upload pipelines for getting the data into the database, and you have to keep in mind that the intention is to not only that there are multiple data sources, but also that regular updates of data need to be are necessary and need to be accommodated for. Also, with respect to security, data must be not only be anonymized, but also be securely transferred to the database. And next to that, there is also done a curation step, on which I will report in the later slides. Curations, if applied, they are approved by the institute themselves, so we just don't do it by ourselves, but it is after approval of the institute. And also, there is a check on the compliance of the codebook of the curated data. And after the data has been loaded into the database, and the statisticians need to work with it, so there's also a step where we designed and constructed exchange pipeline between the active surveillance database and the so-called active surveillance statistical analysis environment, which basically is R and R Studio that the statisticians want to use to analyze the data. This gives an overview of all the components and the flow of data in the whole setup. To the left, you see the institutes, the core institutes, the four core institutes. Next to that, there are 10 satellite institutes that also provide data to one of the core institutes. The data is then transferred to what we call a DMZ, a place where the data is checked whether it is properly anonymized. We don't want non-properly anonymized data to enter the database or even enter the data environment here to the right. If that's all okay, then it is transferred to the active surveillance database. If not, then we ask the institutes to redo their work and better anonymize the data. The core centers or the centers are responsible themselves for proper anonymization of the data. They follow standard procedures, remove dates of births, name, addresses, hospital IDs, all that is needed to and other sensitive information, all that is needed to anonymize the patient data. They assign a pseudonym to the subjects. This allows us to later on associate other data with the same patient, so that anonymization, of course, is of the pseudonymization is done so that the data cannot be traced back to a person. Then the procedure is that the person, so the IT person at the institute contacts the data manager, and this will initiate the transfer process of the data that I will explain in the next sheet. So the data then goes into the so-called landing zone, and there is a check for anonymization. The transfer between the institutes and the DMZ is done using a tool it's called SDT for secure data transfer. Here are some details. It's all about security, encryption, and so on. The data is also encrypted, kept encrypted in the DMZ. another sheet on the security and privacy part, even more detail about how we access all the data and the tools that are used and the protocols that are used to do it all secure. There's a poster on it later this afternoon, created by a colleague of us, Daniel Platea. So this is all about security, but now more about the content. So we have to deal with 14 institutes initially, but 14 institutes also means 14 different code books, typically. So what has been the approach in this project is that to come up with a common CAP3 codebook. It was based on the inputs from the four different core centers, but from that a common codebook is derived, so that the database is filled with data that is according to one specific CAP3 codebook. But that's not for free. So this is how the codebook looks like. It consists of three parts. So you have inclusion variables that are collected at inclusion. Those are 76 items and some 55 questionnaires. It's basically baseline information and patient background information. There is follow-up data, another section of follow-up data. Each follow-up may contain up to 39 variables and additionally, if available, 55 questionnaires. And follow-up data, of course, is then collected at multiple points in time, and there is final data or end data, so data about the status of the subject at the end of active surveillance. This is also depicted how it looks like. So basically, it's about longitudinal data is in the follow-up for each subject. Sorry. For each subject, you have a number of follow-up information, different for every subject, and the end information might be present or not, depending on the status of the subject, whether he's still in active surveillance or not. Quality, so data quality and data format. So although we have a code book, still there are some problems in getting from the institutes the data in the right format. They either provide data files with less columns, with so basically the data files are comma separated or tab separated files. So they provide data with less or with extra columns, different column order, different column names to so that you're not sure what is in the column, different data types. So we agreed upon to put a yes or a no as a answer to a question, and data it's filled in as a 0 and a 1. The data contains out of range numerical values, out of range categorical values. Sometimes it's very difficult to make a distinction whether a 0 that's put there, whether it really means 0, or whether they just put the default number 0 there, and basically should be not available. We don't have that measurement. And inconsistent data, inconsistent or contradicting values, time of follow-up later than time of death. So the data upload process is, we have extended it, the data upload process with the creation and validation pipeline next to the loading. So the process is now in basically in two steps. One step where we do reformatting, creation and validation. This maps onto files that can directly go into Transmart using the standard Transmart batch tool and end up in Transmart. The formatting and the creation and validation has become the rules, and the descriptions for it have become a part of the column mapping and the word mapping file that people that do data loading are well know well, because they are the same for the loading into Transmart. And this is a three steps process. So first there is the reformatting of the columns. So this is more or less a column to column map. So to make sure that we come to what we would call a format compliant data file for all institutes, so that we have for all institutes exactly the same format of the files. This is how it looks like if you look at the column map that describes how that formatting and reordering of columns should be done. This is depicted here, and this is how the order is in as it should be loaded into Transmart, and as it is mapped onto the concepts in Transmart. Then there is a creation step where in the word map you can specify how you want to make some modifications to the data. This process is expressed as a sequence of smaller steps. Each step affects only one single column, but multiple columns might be involved in trying to express what needs to be done in that step. And also the creation step is applied to a subset of the rows that match specific criterion for applying that change. And that's depicted in the word map file, where the traditional word map file would allow you to do something like this. So if you encounter a value, a string EBRT, then this is replaced by this full name, but this is applied only for the rows that have this value. So this is more or less a condition for this modification, but we allow maybe complicated type of modifications, but you can also express with regular expressions and even with functions specify a modification. For example, specify the BMI that is derived from two other columns which report on the height and the weight of a patient, or calculate the HS diagnosis from the year of diagnosis and the year of birth. This whole word mapping can be done using these kind of expressions. So basically you have a pattern meshing expression that allows you to specify what should be modified into what in the substitution expression. You can also use a function for that to specify how it should be changed and do some calculations. So for example here, remove the unit and translate it to the unit that has been agreed upon in the code book, if that would be meters. You can also specify a logical function that selects which rows need to be modified. So for example, if some of the values cannot be interpreted as a number, then the value is substituted by, in this example, by -1 or even more complicated things. Also for the validation, we allow to specify some conformance rules. So in the end, what the data that is in the column should conform to. This is done per column, so you can specify what are the restrictions for certain variables in terms of how it should be structured, what are the possible options for a categorical variable, what are the ranges in which a variable should be given. And this will all end up in a conformance report that reports on all the things that all the violations that you encountered in the data. So if you do this process, this is completely automated, as you can express, and it also you've documented all the changes that you could also have done manually, but now you've documented it, and that makes it repeatable. So if the institute now hands over a new data set with new data, you can just go through this this process without any manual intervention and process that new data. This is how it looks like in the in Transmart, of course. The follow-up data is put in the structure in this way, so you have separate concepts for each follow-up month. Within each follow-up, you have all the concepts that have been made available by the institutes, of all the data that has been made available. So this is how we currently model the longitudinal data. And as we already heard a number of times, so there is a need for a better support for longitudinal data in Transmart. So typically we have these kind of data sets in our project. For patients we have values at specific dates. Sometimes you have at those dates missing values, so that's also not not fully filled, these tables. And this is how you maybe would like to visualize it in Transmart if you want to look at longitudinal data. One of the drawbacks of this absolute time is that you cannot easily compare graphs for the same variable, because they are at a different point in time. So there's also need to use relative time points, or to be able to use relative time points, so that the graphs can be easily compared relative to a specific point in time for that patient, for example, the date of diagnosis. This is what you would like to do maybe with data that is for to have graphs of the whole set of longitudinal data. But also there is, I think, a need for people that want to work with the data to specify and retrieve specific observations. So observations done at a specific moment in time, so at a specific event. So for example, you could be interested to look at a particular marker, the value of a particular marker, but the one measured at or before a certain, the PSA level rises above a certain level for the first time. So that's with longitudinal data. So you have to somehow to be able to specify which time point you are interested in, and you have to specify that for multiple patients which have different values at different points in time. So an event set could be a handy way to depict those to calculate those events. For example, if you would be able to specify an event set like the first occurrence of a PSA value above 10, those events depicted here in these red circles, then these steps allows you to also specify another event based on that event set, but saying, okay, I am interested in the events of Gleason that took place before this PSA event for the last time. And then you would be easy, then it would be easy to, based on those event sets, to retrieve certain observations to be used in analysis. Because in the end, you maybe want to compare these Gleason observations among all those patients that are in your cohort. This was a sidestep on longitudinal data, but the kind of support we would like to see available in Transmart. So if all the data is in Transmart, this is a familiar picture. This is how it looks like for the GrabTree data. This is of course only a part of the tree. You can do the basic things like the summary statistics and all the analysis that are available in Transmart. And we also made a connection with an advanced analysis environment for those analysis that cannot be done in Transmart by the statisticians of the project. So this is the current status of the data set. So 14 core centers, 11 satellite centers total. We have over 40,000 patients, and because of the regular updates, we also have a versioning on the data set itself. So we are currently at version 2.1. Yeah, the advanced analysis is basically a combination of Transmart and RStudio that are connected for the statisticians, so they can do their analysis in their environment that they know, retrieve the data from Transmart and work with the data as they feel as they really know and feel fine with. But because one of the requirements was that the data should from the project itself, the data should not be distributed on all kinds of computers, local, not even from the statisticians. So we had to build an environment where the statisticians could work and do the analysis. And we created that so they can enter that analysis environment with the push of a button and do their analysis in R as they feel fit. So I want to conclude with some conclusions. The data management tooling allows us now to specify a common and repeatable data curation and validation process prior to loading the data into Transmart. Although the data management tooling has been developed focusing on the GrabTree project, we think it might be useful for other projects as well. There's also, because of the follow-up data, support needed for more longitudinal support needed in Transmart. And the advanced analysis environment with RStudio supports researchers that need to do more advanced analysis than the built-in analysis in Transmart. Thank you for your attention. Sorry, some acknowledgements, of course. my colleagues from Philips Research, Movember Foundation, people from the Erasmus, the main clinical partner in the project, the IT specialists from the core and the satellite centers, and of course also CTMM Trade, were part of the work was done in.